the repatriation of overseas Filipino workers from the Middle East. Joining us on the line now is Administrator Hans Leo Cacdac. He's the chief of the Overseas Workers Welfare Administration. Administrator Cacdac, thank you for taking our call despite your busy schedule. We really appreciate it.
Yes, good noon, Ms. Carmina, and to your televiewers, good noon as well.
So when are you leaving? Are you preparing as we speak? When is your flight out?
Yes, we're just finalizing the travel documentation, and we'll leave it as soon as possible time, most likely either Sunday or Monday.
All right. Now, this mission, it's not going to be easy, is it? How complicated will it be for you and your team?
Well, my mission, based on Secretary Belge's directives, is to head for Saudi and Kuwait. So there we will talk to, of course, first and foremost, the embassies, the ambassadors, and discuss plans that they have, contingency measures that are in place. And with respect to the current situation, Saudi and Kuwait are not under mandatory repatriation, so the contingency measures will cover preparations and ways in which there could be adequate communication lines between the Filipino community and the Philippine embassy and the Philippine Labor Office there. And along these lines, we, of course, will get in touch with the Filipino community leaders. We'll talk to them and get their views, their insight, as well as inform them of the current Philippine government efforts. Again, not in the context of mass repatriation, but merely in the context of preparing for the eventuality.
Yeah, we understand that it's not under mandatory repatriation, but it has been flagged as a possible transit point for those who will be extracted from conflict areas. So that's going to be a busy hub, the areas that are under your watch, Mr. Administrator.
Well, that remains to be seen. Yesterday, Secretary Simato, insofar as Iraq is concerned, had identified transit areas, transit points. He did not mention Saudi nor Kuwait, but that doesn't close the possibility. We will also be meeting with Ministry of Labor officials in Saudi and government officials in Kuwait as to the protection, continued protection of our workers there. So we will, right now, we are, in a state where we are still open to the possibility as to whether Saudi or Kuwait will be staging points or will be transit points for repatriated workers out of Iraq or Iran in the event.
Administrator Cacdac, recently you were able to speak with an overseas Filipino worker who's stranded in Baghdad, their employer asking for $8,000 per head before they can be let go. How will you go about that extraction?
Well, we've seen this happen in Syria when there were mass repatriations about 6-7 years ago.
Yeah.
And most likely what will happen there is that the personnel, Philippine government personnel on the ground, mainly the Philippine embassy in Baghdad, officials there. We know Seximato and his team are in the Middle East or are headed for the Middle East. So that matter will be left to the teams, the Philippine teams on the ground. We can't have a one-size-fits-all response to that scenario because definitely, just by the mere first blush or brush, at least with the question, it's difficult to say yes, because these are demands of a private entity, an employer of Filipino workers, and it's hard to dig into government coffers to respond to the needs of a private entity, private employer. So there are questions, of course. On the other hand, there is a need to repatriate our people. So there will be some sort of a balancing approach here, that I see. And I want to keep this open and flexible so that our Philippine government functionaries on the ground will have the elbow room to decide.
Yeah, and this just really paints a picture of how complicated it will be, because as you said, there's no one-size-fits-all extraction plan for these employers. In this particular case, we're talking about undocumented workers here. There are about 60 of them, I believe, and they're employed by only one employer. How many more are similarly situated, Administrator?
Well, there will be more employers, obviously, if you're talking of Baghdad and the other place where there would be many OFWs, Erbil, or the northern part in Kurdistan, a semi-autonomous region. But let me just assure everyone that this is not new, fortunately or unfortunately, because there have been previous security crises for OFWs in areas such as Syria and Libya and Lebanon in the past. This is nothing new in terms of how the Philippine government will engage the dilemmas in which our workers are placed. As I said, in Syria, we've heard these types of situations where employers build hurdles around the mass repatriation of our workers. But again, there have been solutions and there will be solutions that our Philippine teams on the ground will come up with.
You also voiced a concern, Administrator Cacdac, that recruitment may be happening as we speak because of the possibility of, you know, employees being extracted, and therefore they need to replace those employees who will be leaving their employ. What are you doing about that?
Yes, that's the value of coming forward. And then for the last few days, all government elements or members of the interagency group set up by the president have been making this call, this one call that people should come forward so that we know who they are and we know who their employers are. Because if you're looking at Iraq, for instance, where there is a standing ban on the deployment of overseas Filipino workers, knowing their employers would also mean that there would be a lookout in terms of the departure point in Manila or elsewhere in the Philippines, of the Bureau of Immigration to be alerted in this regard. So we will be notified, and that is why when I was interviewed about the case of the manicurists in Baghdad this morning, I wanted or asked for information about the name of the employer, because then we would have to flag the Bureau of Immigration and other related government entities, implementing agencies, law enforcement, so that deployment of Filipinos to these types of employers will be stopped or averted.
Now, the stranded worker that you spoke with this morning also said that they don't trust the officials of the Philippine Embassy in Iraq. What were the reasons that she gave you? I understand that you talked to her privately after that interview.
Sorry, I didn't catch that last comment.
During that interview, she was asking that she speak to you privately. Did that ever happen?
Yes,
and what were the reasons given to you why?
I'm still awaiting the contact info. But rest assured, within the day, we will communicate with her and her group. So that we will know fully the extent. And I've also reached out to the necessary government entities, institutions, so that we can address their plight. And we know now also that Simato is en route to the Middle East.
Yeah.
So things will clear up definitely once the head of the interagency team on the government repatriation effort will arrive in the Middle East.
If you have that kind of a concern coming from affected overseas Filipino workers saying that they don't trust the Philippine Embassy or officials of the Philippine Embassy in Iraq, what kind of an impact do you think will this have on repatriation efforts? And what assurance can you give these workers that Philippine officials can be trusted, especially during these times?
Well, I think with regard to the trust factor, I think the president is clear that there is a directive for Philippine government personnel, institutions to undertake the mass repatriation of Filipinos in the affected areas, so that the relevant government entities, agencies will act accordingly, will carry out the president's mandate. In other words, with this president's mandate will be an effort to restore, enhance, strengthen, maintain the people's trust. So we would just have to keep engaging. That's basically the bottom line for the Philippine government. A constituent or a client may be downhearted and may be disheartened or discouraged to approach us, but we will have to emphasize the need to bring them home and restore, if not strengthen, their trust and faith in the government process.
Overseas Workers Welfare Administration Administrator Hans Leo Cacdac, as always, thank you for taking our call. We really appreciate you taking time out to talk to us this noon. And take care.
Thank you, ma'am, and thank you.